Hello, my name is Miklós Fada. In the following, I give you a short introduction to the FIPP model. There are two basic terms FIPP operates with: self and environment. If we want to be simple and visual, we can imagine self as a camera which continuously records what is around. If we take it like that, let's call environment what is in the camera's viewer and is going to be recorded. The camera can move around and has the ability to zoom on different things. Both the self and the environment has a subjective size perceived by the self. It is important to underline that this subjective size has nothing to do with real sizes or dimensions. It is a completely subjective quantity perceived uniquely by the person. These sizes can change over time. The question is, how does it change and why? Let's illustrate how is the proportion of the self compared to environment changing during a psychic process. This axis shows the self of the size, this one the time. We illustrate the self, which is big compared to the environment in this area, by the small self in this area. Let's start with the beginning state when the self is in balance with the environment. As the process progresses, the self is becoming smaller and smaller until it reaches a minimum point. At this minimum point, something happens and suddenly the self explodes and becomes much bigger than it originally was. The first stage we can call self-narrowing, while the second stage we can call self-expansion. I try to illustrate this pattern, for example, during problem solving. In this example, the problem will be the environment as the self is facing that. Do you remember the comparison with the camera? The camera, the self, is recording with increasing zoom the problem as the environment. When we face a problem here, it has almost nothing to do with ourself. As the time goes and we got more and more involved, still not being able to solve it, we feel ourselves smaller and smaller and the problem bigger and bigger. When we are close to give up here, something happens and we find a solution. That is the point when we become very happy and we would like to embrace the whole world, or at least our friends, by telling them the solution or the fact that we have solved something. The question is, what has happened at the minimum point? In order to understand what happens behind this pattern, we have to introduce the term of cognitive schemata. The cognitive schemata are the elements of our mental activities, like the categories, ideas, words, theories, laws, or paradigms. A problem we face is nothing else than two schemata that do not fit, with yellow and blue. For example, the question, should I go to the cinema or should I visit my friends? The unfitting relationship is shown by the red minus. As the time goes, the conflict between the two schemata is bigger and bigger, as its children's schemata turns out to be also in conflict. At the minimum point, the two schemata force into species and creates a new one, shown with green. For example, I ask my friends to join me for the cinema. The birth of this new schemata is what changes the direction of the pattern, and this new schema is what has to be communicated to the social environment. Here you can see the whole process, including the cognitive schemata and their relationship. This is the minimum point, where from the blue and the yellow, a green new schemata has born. And this green schemata is growing bigger and bigger until it is started to be communicated to the social environment. What is all this good for? As the pattern can be identified in many different psychic processes on different levels and scales of life, it gives a good frame to start research more effectively the human soul. The very few terms it operates with might be understood and used by a wider range of researchers, including also non-psychologists and laymen. Some areas where you can easily identify the pattern: sexual relationship, arts psychology, function practice and learning, sports, e.g. long running, hypnosis. If you became interested